All right. This evening we'll be in Revelation chapters 8 and 9. That's my goal, to cover both of those chapters. And we'll see if we can get through them both. This is an interesting section of the book. There's a lot of graphic kind of things that are happening in chapters 8 and 9. As we get there, you'll see it in just a moment. I was asked to remind you folks that everything that we're seeing here is a vision that John saw. It's not things that really happened. It's a vision that he's seen. God has given him this vision. He's not up in heaven seeing these things. He's not seeing events that are going to happen in the future. He's seeing a vision of this. So God is giving him this vision of what's going to happen. So it's almost like a dream of sorts. You'll remember the sealed scroll was introduced back in chapter 5. The seals were opened up to the sixth seal in chapter 6. And so we got as far as six seals, and we're getting ready to get to number 7. We waited for the last seal to be opened and the contents to be revealed, but we were given a pause in chapter 7. And you'll remember in that pause, there were 144,000 folks who got the seal on their head. And we talked about that. And so, and there was going to be this multitude of great multitude and a great tribulation. Those were the deals that we saw before. So we start now in chapter 9. When the Lamb broke the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about a half hour. Now that's interesting. Silence for half an hour. Now the idea of the pause between chapter the sixth and seventh seal is emphasized by this silence for about half an hour, which I think is interesting. The silence itself is striking. That's a little unusual. Some have seen it as a kind of breathing space where the angels are silent so that the prayers of the believers can go up to heaven, or maybe it's the cry of the martyrs that we saw back in chapter 6, and there's silence so that that can happen. I don't know that that's the case. I think it's more likely that the silence in heaven demonstrates a sober, awestruck silence that judgment has come. And now the seals are off, and the scroll can be opened. And so that's going to be important. The silence in heaven is about a half an hour. A half an hour of silence is not that long. However, it can either seem short or long. If I were to get up on Sunday and say nothing for even 10 minutes, you guys would say, "What?" You know, that little bit of silence would be a big deal. And so I think that's the case. If a preacher were to stop his sermon and be silent for 10 minutes, it would seem like an eternity. And so this may seem like a long time as he's waiting for something to happen. So there's a silence for half an hour. Since heaven is a place of constant praise and worship to God, we saw that back in chapter 4, the silence of a half an hour is a pretty long time because everybody's been praising God. We're now going to get seven angels and seven trumpets that are going to sound. Now that's going to be interesting. Seven angels and seven trumpets. So here we go. "And I saw seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them." Okay, so each angel has a trumpet, and they're about to blow the trumpet. The trumpets are sounded as a warning. The seals are broken. That's revelation of what God's going to do. The trumpets are blown, and a warning. You'll remember that they blow trumpets when you're going to charge or when you need to retreat, but it's a warning. And then there are going to be bowls of wrath that will be poured out. And that's going to be punishment. God is angry and he's going to punish folks who are sinners. The stage is set for the warnings now, and so we're ready for those warnings, the trumpets and the warnings. According to Jewish tradition, there were always seven angels who stood in God's presence. And that's, interestingly enough, John is playing off of that, and that's exactly what he sees. Seven angels who are standing there in the presence of God who are going to blow these trumpets. To them are given seven trumpets. That's what our text says. In the Old Testament, trumpets sounded as an alarm for war, and they would sometimes throw the enemy into panic. And they were also called, were used to call an assembly of God's people. So sort of like ringing a bell, you know, churches that have their bells that will ring when it's time to come to church. And so it's that kind of call for that as well. You may remember they marched around the city of Jericho 7 days for 7 days one time, those 7 days, and on the seventh day they march around seven times and blow the trumpets and the walls fall down. And so something is about to happen that's going to be significant. The seven trumpets will sound as God's battle warning, a battle alarm during the great tribulation. So here we go. Another angel came and stood at the altar holding a gold censer. Much incense was given to him so that he might add it to the prayers of the saints on the golden altar which was before the throne. Then the angel took the censer and filled it up with fire from of the altar and threw it on the earth. And there followed peals of thunder and sounds and flashes of lightning and an earthquake. Okay, so here we go. Prior to the sound of the trumpets, there are the prayers of the Christians that are going up. And it's really interesting to me that you get this kind of language here. Some see this angel who is bringing the censer, etc., as Jesus, because even that angel of the Lord language is used in the Old Testament to refer to the Messiah. But I don't think that's the case. It's much more likely this is a mere angelic being. The word another in the text means another one like the others. And so I don't think that's Jesus, because he's not like the others, right? This is another one. He is like the other angels we've just seen. Prayer and incense are often associated in the Bible. In fact, that whole idea of burning incense in the temple was a symbol of what they were doing outside as they were praying. Folks outside are praying while the priests are burning the incense, and the incense goes up to God. The idea is just as the incense is precious and pleasant, it drifts to heaven, so do our prayers just sort of drift up to heaven, and God hears them all. And so it's an interesting symbol, symbolic in the Old Testament, and we see it here as well. So here, before anything happens at the opening of the seventh seal, the prayers of God's people come before the Lord God. Significantly, the prayers of the people set in motion the coming consummation of history. Everything is going to happen because of the prayers of the saints. God's going to finally redeem the world, and that will be important. This is a quote from a man named Torrance. It is these prayers, he's talking about the prayers, are more potent, more powerful than all the dark and mighty powers let loose in the world. More powerful than anything else is the power of prayer, set ablaze by the fire of God and cast upon the earth. So prayers are significant. God hears them and they make a difference. And he's making a big deal of that. You see in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 and 12, that we are supposed to pray hastening the day of the Lord. The Lord's going to come again, and we're praying to bring about what he's going to do. Here we see that we can also hasten the Lord's coming through prayer, even as Daniel asked for a speedy fulfillment of prophecy in for Israel in Daniel chapter 9. We can also pray, even so, come Lord Jesus. You'll see that in Revelation 22. That's a legitimate prayer for us. Even come, so Lord Jesus. We're ready, Lord. Whenever you're ready, we're ready. And that's the call for us to be ready. So when you're ready, Lord, we're ready. This is a quote from Clark. It is not said that the angel presents the prayers. It's not that he gives the prayers. He presents the incense, and the prayers ascend with the incense. The prayers are going up just naturally. You see, God's going to hear our prayers. Nobody has to deliver those prayers. It's not like God has to have somebody bring them to him. They ascend and God accepts them, and that becomes important. Then the angel took the censer and he filled it with fire from the altar and he threw it to the earth. Again, this is language playing clearly off of temple time. And so he's going to take this altar of incense, of fire that is burning beneath the incense to make it smell, and he throws it on the earth. As God's people pray for resolution of things, their prayers are touched by fire from the altar of heaven and thrown back down to the earth. All things will not be resolved on this earth until judgment comes, And when the prayers of God's people come back to the earth, they will bring a groundswell of judgment, noises, thunderings, lightning, earthquake. Again, this is interesting language. It's really kind of picturesque. As you're almost, again, supposed to see the drama acted out. Again, I was trying to remember which professor it was when I was in seminary, but I think it was Beasley Murray who was the one who was convinced that this is really a drama that needs to be acted out, and that we need to see it acted out. So the seven angels who had seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Again, that's a direct quote. We waited for the seven seals to be opened and saw them loosed one by one. But when the seventh seal was finally loosed, the end didn't come immediately, and we kind of expected the end. To set in motion the seven trumpets would sound upon the earth. In considering how the seals and trumpets relate to each other, some believe there's a poetic repetition here. And in fact, the language of all of these seems to repeat itself. We're going to see some similar things. The different words and details, both of the seals and the judgment and the trumpets, I think, are all judgment kind of language. This is from Leon Morris, again, a great commentator who died not too long ago. This is typical of John's method. He goes over ground again and again, each time teaching something new. There is no more to the end than we have already than we can readily take in. Every series of visions brings out new facets of it. So each vision will bring something new, but there's not a lot that is new. There's repetition. We'll see it. In considering how the seals and the trumpets relate to each other, some believe they are sequential. One happens, then the other happens, then the next happens, then the next happens. That the seventh seal contains the seven trumpets, and the seven trumpets contain the seven bowls of judgment. Yet there are problems with any kind of sequential approach. I don't know that you need to have this one happen, they don't have to happen in that order, necessarily. For example, the people of Revelation chapter 6, verses 15 through 17 are mistaken about Jesus' return. They don't seem to be. No, they kind of know it hasn't come yet. If the trumpets simply follow in sequence to the seals, then there's a striking display of God's mercy in stretching out the end and allowing repentance. He doesn't bring it immediately. He could bring an end, but he's giving folks a chance to repent. And that's a language, you especially get that in Peter. Peter makes this big deal of God hasn't brought judgment. You guys are worried that it hasn't happened yet. But you know, we need to be grateful that it hadn't happened, because we would have had a chance to repent. And because we've been given this wonderful chance of repentance, you see this mercy of God. Since John brings the report from eternity, it's difficult to assign chronological and sequential elements to these judgments. Again, it's coming from God up in eternity, and so he sees these things, but they don't have to happen one right after the other. They're not necessarily sequential. It's most important to emphasize that they are real, even if their sequence is hard to pin down with certainty. Now in Revelation, we come to the seven trumpets. Chapter 8, verses 6 through 9, 13, we have six trumpets that will be sounded. And again, it's really interesting. We get to number 7, and number 7 always holds us up. Seven with the seals holds us up, and seven with the trumpets is going to hold us up a bit as well. In chapters 10 and 11, there'll be an interlude, and we'll finally get the seventh trumpet in chapter 11, verses 15 through 19. Now, see what we've seen so far? We've opened the seals, we got six of them, and we're waiting for the seventh. And we're going to get six trumpets, and we're going to wait for the seventh. And so that will be important. Remember, the trumpets are sounded as a warning. Beale does a very good job of providing some Old Testament background regarding the plagues in Israel and the trumpets of Revelation. He thinks the plagues that Israel faced are very much Israel saw in Egypt are very much like the trumpets in the book of Revelation. And I think you'll see some similarities. The trumpets serve two purposes. They announce God's victory to his people, and they warn of the impenitent, the unrepentant folks of the events that are going to come. Considering the character of those who persecuted Christians, it's amazing that God gave them another opportunity to repent. He's given them more chance. And that's amazing. Okay, the first of the four trumpets in chapter 8, verses 6 through 12. Be careful not to major in minors. We want to spend everything and try to figure out all of the details and make them all stand for it. Don't try to do that. We'll see that as we move through. Okay, here we go. And the same that seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. The first sounded, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood. And they were thrown to the earth. And a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all of the green grass was burned up. Okay, so this is an ecological terrible event. The first trumpet brings a plague on vegetation. Okay, so that's the plague. The first trumpet sounded, hail and fire are followed, mingled with blood, and they were thrown to the earth. A third of the trees are burned up, all of the green grass is burned up. And so you can see the terrible things. Hail and fire followed, mingled with blood. Blood may just indicate the color of it all. It's red, a phenomena that's happening. We don't know if the hail and fire was red in color or it brought forth red blood, and we don't know which those are. The third of the trees are burned up and all the green grass is burned up because of this hail and fire. Trees and grass are destroyed. A third of the vegetation of the planet is burned up during this great tribulation. How will this happen? Interestingly enough, there are a lot of folks today who want to try to tie it to some kind of event that is going to happen. There's going to be a nuclear war. You know, that sounds like one of those horror movies, doesn't it? A nuclear war, and that's what will cause it all to happen. Or maybe it will be something, a fallout of something. Or maybe it's the pollution that we're getting in the air that's going to cause all these terrible things to happen. Or maybe it's a meteor that's going to strike and so forth. So everybody is guessing as to exactly how God's going to pull this off in a literal way. These ideas, I think, are interesting, but they should never obscure the essential truth. The truth here is, God is going to bring judgment, and that judgment is going to be terrible on those who are unbelievers. Judgment is coming. And so I think that's the basic picture. I don't think you're supposed to take this literally. Everything has been symbolic that we've seen so far, but I think that's the point. God isn't a passive bystander. It's not things are just taking, nature taking its course, things are just happening this way, we had this terrible pandemic, because God has a hand in it all. And all of that's important. Okay, angel number two. The second angel sounded, something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea. And a third of the sea was blood, became blood, and a third of the creatures that were in it, and had life died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. A third, a third, a third. Everybody see that? All those thirds. The second angel brings a plague on the sea. The mountain is cast into the sea, and that ought to call folks to repentance. There's something terrible that happens, and they should repent because of it. Something like a great mountain. Notice John is very careful to say it's not a real mountain that goes into the sea, but it's something like a mountain. It almost sounds like a volcano that goes into the sea. I mean, because it's got fire and all of that that goes with it. It's a blazing mass as a mountain. The third of the sea becomes like blood. Again, that sounds a little like Egypt and the curse, one of the curses down there, the plagues down there. This disaster is cataclysmic. Perhaps a meteor crashes into the sea. It doesn't really tell us. The result is that a third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships are destroyed. The sea may be a reference to the Mediterranean, and not necessarily all of the oceans on the earth necessarily, because the Mediterranean is where good old John is. In the world of John, the Apostle John, the Mediterranean Sea was the sea. I mean, that's the one they all know, because that's where they're going to sail. And they really had very little knowledge of any other seas. It is common to take the great mountain as a symbol for a nation that will be judged. a mountain ablaze being moved in Old Testament times symbolized great trouble. And it could be that he's here talking about Rome. And it's going to be tossed into the sea. Okay, angel number three. A third angel sounded. That's another trumpet, right? A third angel sounded, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch, and it fell on a third of the rivers and the springs of the waters, and the name of the star is Wormwood. And a third of the waters became wormwood, and many men died from waters because they were made bitter. Okay, so now we have yet another one. This time it's affecting the fresh water. We had the sea water, right, because it was the sea before. Now it's the fresh water, so there's a plague on the fresh water, the drinking water. The fresh water supply is contaminated. The flaming star fell from heaven like a blazing torch, and the name is Wormwood. Bitterness of wormwood always stood for bitterness of judgment of God upon the disobedient. That's always the case. You must turn your justice to wormwood and lay righteousness to rest. That's Amos chapter 5, where he uses that language. It's also used in Amos 6. Do horses run on rocks? Does one plow with oxen? Yet you have turned justice to gall and the fruit of righteousness into wormwood. And wormwood, interestingly enough, is something that's very, very bitter. And that becomes important. Okay, number four. The fourth angel sounded, and a third of the sun, and a third of the moon, and a third of the stars were struck, so that a third of them would be darkened, and the day would not shine for a third of it, and the night in the same way. Okay, so for a third of the daytime, you're not going to see the sun, and a third of the night, you're not going to see the moon or the stars. And so it's going to be really important. The fourth trumpet brings a plague on the heavens and darkness on the earth. Again, remember, darkness was one of the plagues, right? Remember, way back in Egypt, darkness was one of the plagues. Sun and moon and stars are symbols of a violent overthrow of rulers and governments because many of them thought they were that. You may remember this from Genesis, where good old Joseph talks about stars and sun and moon. Joseph dreamed still another dream, and he told his brothers, saying, "Look, I dreamed the other day another dream, and this time the sun and the moon and the 11 stars bowed down to me." Of course, they understood what he's talking about because there are 11 of them, and mama and daddy. Daddy is the sun, and mama's the moon, and so they're all going to bow down and worship him. But they're using that same kind of language, at least. The whole of God's universe is used of God to warn and call people to repentance. It's time to repent. A third, again, means it's not a final overthrow. It's a third of everything. It's been a third, a third, a third, a third, all the way through. It seems the entire universe is used by God to call men to repentance and to warn warn mankind. The seven trumpets, like the seven seals, divide themselves into, interestingly enough, two groups. The first four are similar to plagues in Egypt, with hail and fire and so forth. The last three are more terrible and unique in their aspect. The fire burns up a third of everything, the land, the sea, maybe an image of Vesuvius and Pompeii, mountain burning with fire thrown into the sea, and fresh water, and then the heavens. It seems that these may indicate, be indicative of of natural calamities. The people should have taken account spiritually and repented. When you see calamities happening, bad things happen, you need to repent. And one of the things that we all should have done, if we haven't done it already, in this terrible pandemic we've gone through, is we all should have repented. Right? I mean, when terrible things happen, it's a call from God for us to repent. And so that becomes important. Each time, it's a third that is impacted. The partial judgment gives men an opportunity to repent. Only it's a third of the folks, the things that get affected, and so they have chance to repent. These sounds and events are symbolic indicators of divine judgment that's going to fall on the earth. Okay, now there's a bit of a break here. Then I looked, and I heard an eagle flying in the heaven. saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to those who dwell on the earth because of the remaining blast of the trumpet of the three angels who are about to sound." Okay, we've gone through four. We got three more to go. And so we're ready for that. The word eagle here can either mean an eagle or a vulture. Now, you know, we know eagles. Eagles are predators to some degree, but vultures are carnivorous and they're terrible, terrible animals. And it almost might be better to see it here. And it's interesting, it's woe, woe, woe. It's really interesting because the word in Greek is ooi, 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 woe, woe, woe. It's kind of like ooey, ooey, ooey. It's bad, okay? It's really bad. And it's a woe. A woe is a condemnation. And notice the vulture or the eagle doesn't pronounce the woe regarding the first four trumpets. It's not the first four trumpets that are so bad. It's what's about to happen that is so bad. The woe is regarding the thing to come. You think it's been bad? It's going to get worse. And that will be the case. It's going to get worse. Then the fifth angel sounded. Okay, that's trumpet number five. And I saw a star from heaven which had fallen to the earth, and the key of the bottomless pit was given to him. Now, this is the one that's really quite interesting. There's a big debate about exactly who this fifth angel is. Not who this fifth angel is, who this star is. By the way, you'll notice the star is a hymn at the end of the verse. The star falls from heaven, and the key to the bottomless pit is given to him. So the star is somebody. Are you with me? Okay, we'll talk about that in a second. The fifth angel sounds the trumpet. There were seven seals, thematically, if not chronologically, by seven trumpets. In their arranged order, they are similar. The first four seals and trumpets presented judgments directed against the earth. And the last four seals and the last with the four horsemen bring tyranny, war, famine, and death on the earth. And now we're going to get the four trumpets, which are going to bring ecological destruction of vegetation, seas, and water, fresh water and sky. That's the first four. And then the last three are going to be the cry of martyrs, cosmic disturbance, and a prelude to this, as a prelude to the seven trumpets. The last three trumpets will speak of hell, and they're going to use demonic terms, and I think that's the case. The text clearly shows that this star is a person. As I said earlier, it's a him. To him is given the keys to the kingdom. Not a literal star, it's a him. He's a star that falls from heaven, but it's a him. The verb fallen is a past tense in the original, and it's an interesting past tense. It is has fallen and now stands fallen. And so that becomes a big deal. Who is this star? Suggestions have included Nero, the Emperor Nero, who has died, a fallen angel, an evil spirit, Satan himself, the Word of God, a good angel, and some even want to make it Jesus himself. I think that's very, very unlikely. In the context, this star is best seen as an angel. Whether he's good or bad depends upon his relationship to the angel of the bottomless pit, which we'll meet in verse 11. If the angel of 9:1 is the same angel as 9:11, then it's perhaps Satan himself. Satan falls, and Satan's got the keys to hell, and he's going to open the doors there. If it's a different angel, it may be a good angel sent by God to open up the bottomless pit for his purpose of judgment. And so that's possible. I kind of like to see it as Satan, though. Yes?
Would that go along with Luke 10:18, where Jesus said, "I saw
Satan fall from heaven"? Yeah, and in fact, a lot of folks want to link those passages together to say that. Although I think the Luke passage is, "I saw Satan fall from heaven," is, "I saw Satan falling when you were doing those miracles you were doing." In the Luke passage. I don't think it was falling from heaven initially. But again, some folks have done that. To him is given the keys to the bottomless pit. That this star is fallen makes us associate him with Satan. Since he has fallen, it sounds more like something bad has happened. Another high-ranking evil angelic being, perhaps, if not Satan. This angel, good or evil, serves God's purpose. even if he does not intend to. There's this bottomless pit. And this word abyssos is, or abyssus that we get from it, is a prison for certain demons. And you'll see that in Luke 8 and in 2 Peter 2 and in Jude 6. That's where Satan goes, and that's where all of the folks who are sinners are going to go the judgment day. It's hell. And so we really get a picture of hell. This is probably the same place as the bottomless pit. I think that makes sense. And he opened the bottomless pit, and smoke went up out of the pit like smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by the smoke of the pit. Then out of the smoke came locusts upon the earth. And the power was given them as scorpions of the earth to have power. They were told not to hurt the grass of the earth or any green thing or any tree, but only men who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were not permitted to kill anyone, but to torment for 5 months. And their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it stings a man. In those days, men will seek death and will not find it. They will long to die, and death flees from them. Out of the smoke, locusts came up out of the earth, and so you've got this interesting language. Those are obviously not natural locusts, not a locust as you think of a locust, not a good grasshopper, big grasshopper. It's not that at all. They avoid plants, and they attack men, just like a scorpion might attack a man. The idea is simply that as a part of the judgment of the Great Tribulation, God will allow demonic hordes previously imprisoned to descend upon the earth like a swarm of locust beasts. You kind of see the devil at work in the world today, don't you? And it was in the world around them, and they're going to see it in a very real way. They are not, as some have suggested, heretics or Muslims or Turks or Jesuits or monks or Catholics, and for the Catholics it's Protestants. You know, they're going to make these bad things that are going to come on and pose a problem for people, Protestants, anybody who's not a Roman Catholic. And Protestants, interestingly enough, wanted to make them Roman Catholics. It's the bad Catholics are the bad guys. I don't think that's the point. That's not it at all. They will affect those who don't have the seal on their forehead. That language sounds familiar to us back with 144,000. They all have the seal on their head. Those are the believers, the faithful ones, the saints, the set-apart people. It's an inescapable judgment of God. I've just got that on there twice. Okay, there we go. They were not given authority to kill, but to torment them for 5 months. So it's going to seem like forever, going to seem like a long time. Their purpose and period is expressly governed by God, and the purpose of all of this is to bring repentance. His goal is to get folks to repent. Bad things are going to happen, and they're going to happen so folks will repent. In those days, men will seek death and will not find it. They'll desire to die, and death will flee from them. You're hurting so bad, you're just ready to die. I'm just ready to die. Death will offer no escape from this prolonged torture. Their power is described like the power of scorpions. That's these things they're going to have. The power of scorpions, the bite of a scorpion, though extremely painful, is rarely fatal. You're going to feel like you're ready to die, but you're not going to die. The idea of death is an escape to this from this escape is a demonic deception. The appearance of the locust. Now, here's what these locusts look like. Now, tell me if this looks like any grasshoppers you've ever seen. The appearance of the locust was like this, like horses prepared for battle. On their heads appeared crowns like gold, and their faces were like the faces of men, and they had hair like the hair of women, and they had teeth like the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates like the breastplates of iron, and their sound of their wings was like the sound of chariots of many horses rushing to battle. Doesn't sound like any bugs I've ever seen. Although, you know, what are the things that we're supposed to be having now and we don't have yet? Cicadas, yeah. You know, the cicadas have that terrible kind of sound, and I think it's that kind of terrible sound that he's almost imagining. They have tails like scorpions, and stings in their tails is their power to hurt men for 5 months. They have as their king over them the angel of the abyss. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek he has the name Apollyon. First woe is past. Behold, two woes are still coming after these things. So, remember he said, woe, 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 three woes, and so the first one is past. Further description of the locusts and what they do in verses 7 through 12. The locusts are pictured as an army of soldiers, like horses prepared for battle, heads with crowns on them that are made like gold, that have the face of men. They have women's hair and teeth like lions. Their breastplates are breastplates of iron, and they have the sound of chariots, horses running into battle. They had tails like scorpions with the stings in their tails. Their power, again, is to hurt men for 5 months. And the name of their king means destroyer. He's called Apollyon. And a lot of folks want to see a similarity between Apollyon and Apollo. And they think that John may be taking a jab at Domitian, because Domitian claimed that he was an incarnation of the god Apollo. And he's basically saying, you're the devil. I don't know that that's the case. I think it's better when you see the names pronounced out there and spelled out both in Hebrew and Greek. It is really destruction. That's the point. Interestingly enough, ancient Hebrews referred to locusts, and they had several different names for a locust. They didn't have just one word for locust. It's amazing. Whatever we have the worst of, or whatever is worst or best for us, we give multiple names. Folks in Arabia have multiple names for camels. One-hump camel, two-hump camels, female camel, male camel. They got all kinds of names for camels. Well, the Hebrews had lots of names for locusts. But interestingly enough, every one of those names means destruction. Because what do locusts do? They come and they destroy your crops. And so they're bad. Just as locusts destroy, so can sin destroy. Okay, here we go. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar which is before God, saying to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. And the four angels who had been prepared for the hour and day and month and year were released so that they would kill a third of mankind. And the number of the armies of the horsemen was 200 million. I heard the number of them. And this is how I saw in the vision the horses and those who sat on them. The riders had breastplates the color of fire and of hyacinth and brimstone, and the heads of the horses were like heads of lions, and out of their mouths proceed fire and smoke and brimstone. A third of mankind was killed by these three plagues, by the fire and the smoke and the brimstone which proceeded out of their mouths. For the power of the horses is in their mouths and in their tails. In their tails, they are like serpents and have heads, and they with them they do harm. Okay, trumpet number six. A second woe is pronounced now. So we get to woe number two. We're going to get three woes. This is the second woe. The sixth angel appears, and he blows the trumpet. This is symbolic of the secular power that does its best to overcome God and destroy God's influence in men's lives. The Euphrates River, from which these four angels are going to be called, is used symbolically of foreign powers. Babylonians, Parthians, and others are called from the Euphrates, where there's power. The army beyond the Euphrates, according to Beasley Murray, is more terrible by far than any human or army. And so it's really bad. Many believe a third of the men are killed are all Romans. I don't know that there's any reason to think that. Okay, we read on. The rest of mankind, who were not killed by the plagues, did not repent of the works in their hands, so as not to worship demons and idols of gold and of silver and of brass and of stone and wood, which can neither see nor hear nor walk. They did not repent of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their immorality, nor their thefts. So, the plague and repentance in verses 20 through 21, it is made clear that this attack was a type of plague. Again, you see that in the first part of verse 20. Despite the severe punishment taking place, there were still many who did not and would not repent. Despite the bad things that are going to happen in Rome, at the time that Rome falls, a lot of folks are never going to repent. You'd think they'd come to their senses, but they don't come to their senses. So they don't repent. There's a spiritual battle which rages, and mankind is caught up in it. It's a battle between good and evil, between God and Satan. God would end it all at any could end it all at any moment he chose, suddenly and overwhelmingly. But he's patient. He wants people saved, and he wants them to repent. He's being gracious. God wants mankind to choose good over evil, repentance rather than rebellion. Some chose sin and suffered in its consequences, and so they're going to deal consequently with the sin. Yet God continued to provide the opportunity for repentance. I'm going to give you a chance. I'm going to give you time. I'm going to give you time. And he's been giving folks time now for 2,000 years after this, so we're down the line. Okay. Interesting kind of language. Did you see how gruesome this whole section was, though? All of the terrible things that are going to come, all like plagues of various kinds. But the key is, God wants them to repent, and they're not going to do it. You'd think they would come to their senses. Okay, comments or questions, anybody? I finished at just the right time. That's amazing.
Anybody? Yes.
The seals on the foreheads of the saved, is that kind of like a Passover?
In a way, yeah. Because they put the thing above the door that made sure that, and see, in a very real way, he passes over those folks because they've got the seal. Yeah, yeah. And again, I think it's a little bit like what we do to cattle, where we're going to put a brand on them. And God puts his brand on your forehead so that you know, he knows which ones are his. It's very clear that you're one of his. But that's a good point. Yeah, that's a good point. Yes?
As a young college student, I attended a small country church down in southern West Virginia. And there was one elderly gentleman always ended his prayers with, "Jesus, come quickly," and amen.
Explain why off of Revelation 21. Yeah, that's right.
But as a young man, I heard that man pray that, and I thought, why would he pray that? Now that I am older and look back and have experienced life and am ready for the end, I can understand him saying that. But I never will forget his mannerisms and tone, and it was, you knew how he was going to come to the end of his prayer, because he always said that.
And again, most of us are not ready for the Lord to come yet. You know, we keep thinking, well, I need more time. But if we indeed are repentant folks, it could be any time, and we should be ready for it and rejoice at it. It's good news for us. It's not bad news. Yes?
Curious, Mike, what's the top two or three commentaries you found the most helpful?
Well, I really like, I have George Beasley Murray's, and it's a big, thick old thing, and it's way too big, and it's terrible to read. It's awful. But it's really quite thorough. I really like the one that's in the Pillar series, and I can't remember who wrote it, but it's in a series, and there are pillars on the front of it, but he's the one who did the Pillar series, and I like it about as well as any of them. I'll have to bring the author. I've gone blank on the author's name. In fact, I left all of my Revelation commentaries in my office at school, and I told Jenny that tomorrow I'm going to my office to bring those commentaries home so that I can use them at home instead of having to go to school, because I don't go to school very often during the summer. But I'm going to bring some of those home. But I'll give you two or three really good ones that I think are really quite good. A lot of them are really outrageous. I mean, so they make everything stand for something, and they've got history all the way figured all out, and they have Afghanistan and everybody else in the thing that's around today, and they're just awful. But there are a few that are really quite good. Two or three, I think, that are quite good. A friend of mine gave me one that was written by a friend of his that was just, he said, you need to read this. And I started reading and I said, I'm not reading that. That's awful. And so I have it in my library, but I've never read more than about 10 pages of it because it was so bad. Okay, let's pray as we close. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the ways that you've blessed us. We're grateful for those blessings you shower upon us. We're grateful for the fact that indeed you've given us time to repent and that you care about us and you've been patient with us. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us to share that good news of Jesus with those around us, just as John was hoping to share it with those around him. We pray, Lord, you'd help us to be faithful to you in all that we do. Be with us this week. Help us to live our lives to your glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.